Blade is Star Rail's first high-risk, high-reward DPS, and today, I'm gonna tell you everything you need to know to play him like the edgy lover he is. Now, I know I said he was high-risk, but unlike Arlen, this guy is actually worth it. If you played other games, you've definitely experienced the sacrifice health for an advantage-type character, and Blade follows in suit. With his kit, Blade is capable of dealing high AoE damage while also having the ability to self-sustain with ult. Now, if his looks alone didn't make him feel worth it to pull, you're just wrong. But another interesting note from patch 1.2 is that the new relic sets pair incredibly well with him. Unique husbando, hot, edgy, and does big damage. Let's get into it. Now, like other damage dealers, Blade is straightforward, but with a twist. Yes, there is a level of complication when it comes to timing your ultimate, keeping his health above lethal range, etc. But in general, so long as you maintain your skill buff and AoE, you're headed in the right direction. Something to consider when looking at the way he scales and does damage is the fact that he does well with health. Between his ultimate and talent, there's huge value in having health given just how much it scales Blade's damage. But in actual gameplay scenarios, this is a character who presses skill and hits a few times while making sure to reapply his Hellscape buff. An interesting conversation that will also be had as weeks go by is when the perfect moment to use his ultimate is, since at the moment, it's a double-edged sword that can subtract or add health, do damage, and be a panic button all in one. And of course, that isn't even taken into consideration whether you use him as a primary damage soaker or tank. In the same vein of confusing everyone, there is also great value in being able to proc his talent by being hit by the enemy. But alongside all the other hundreds of factors to consider, you now also need to decide whether you'll take a shielder with Blade. Simple, right? At the end of it all, however, so long as you're alive and doing AoE damage with Hellscape, you're good to go. Ah, the sweet smell of a 5-star released with a light cone. If it weren't obvious enough with Sela, Jingyuan, Silverwolf, and Luoch's releases, the banner light cone always does well with the newly released character. Blade's light cone is no different and may actually prove to just be best in slot. As previously mentioned, Blade scales well with health and still desires damage substats. Therefore, the crit and added health from his own poses extreme value not found on any other destruction light cone. Does this mean that there isn't a 4-star that works for him though? Of course not. However, the real concern lies in the fact that your options for Blade are not ideal outside of Arlen's secret vow light cone. There are other light cones that give some sort of attack scaling, but none provide health or perfect synergy. 3-star light cones like Mutual Demise or Collapsing Sky do great in providing value that isn't just attack percent, but you do run the downside of having 3-star light cone stats. By comparison, Secret Vow has a decent increase in stat while also simply providing a better suited passive. Instead of focusing on attack percent, which Blade scales okay with but not great on, you have damage scaling that is affected by all aspects of his stats. Long story short, his own light cone is perfect, Arlen's follows right after but is accessible only through Stellar Warp, and 3-stars or any other 4-star light cone that you have is serviceable but not great. As you've certainly already guessed, Blade functions very similarly to your run-of-the-mill DPS. And while some aspects differ, the way that you invest in a character like Blade is no different. Upgrading his talent, skill, and ultimate are all critical to playing Blade at his max potential. But where the script changes is that his basic skill requires decent investment as well. Considering the core gameplay loop of activate skill into use basic, upgrading it is equally as important. If looking over at his major traces, you'll notice that they're all somehow incredibly important. Between increased healing or increased damage on his talent, Blade is just yet another DPS who needs all of his major traces activated. A pretty common characteristic shared by all Honkai Star Rail damage dealers is, of course, max investment. And although you're tired of me saying it, you just have to get every single trace if you want to deal the most damage on the character. Side note, since he does scale with health, the HP traces double as survivability enhances and damage increases as well. And finally, if you do want a tiny bit of relief, you don't have to upgrade this single effect res boost over here, which is nice, but you have to upgrade everything else. Now listen, I understand that what I'm about to say will be difficult to accomplish, but it's just the truth. The newly released set pairs perfectly with Blade, and if he can't make great use of them, nobody can. The launch of his Disciple set is just perfect for Blade since it gives HP percent and crit rate, and just read the passive. This was made for Blade. Damage and synergy aside, there is still the issue of being able to farm out a proper 4 set on release, so if you decide to use Musketeer Eagle set, there is still great value. Additionally, given both sets insane value when it comes to flexibility and functionality, Blade can make great use of either set. Whether it be with attack and speed, or through wind and increased turn taking, these sets are the perfect fallback when you're farming out his best in slot. If addressing the new planetary sets, Rudolin Arena also appears to be created specifically for Blade. Free crit rate while also providing increased basic and skill damage simply screams Blade, and there's no getting around it. That being said, neither new set are by any means must have or else the world ends. Simply put, whichever set you can gather the best stats on will ultimately be what you should use on Blade. When choosing Blade's main stats, look no further than a crit rate or crit damage chest depending on your stat ratios. If we go down the line, Blade's boot will stay speed unless you take a character like Bronya. His orb Orb is wind since, well, he's wind elemental, and he gains the most value out of it as opposed to HP or attack. And his rope is best as HP percent, since his damage scales more off of HP percent, and he doesn't really need that much energy regeneration or attack percent. Substat priority is a bit of a nightmare on Blade since he needs tankiness, survivability, and damage to work properly, but ultimately, health ties with crit rate and crit damage, which is then preceded by speed, attack, and defense. Building break effect, effect hit rate, or resist is pretty pointless on him considering a healer is core nowadays in difficult content, and he just doesn't break that well. But it is funny to see Hoyoverse add innate effect resist to his traces and a bonus to hitting enemies that are weakness broken. Like what? I don't think talking about Eidolons on 5 stars is something that most wallets want to do, but it's really hard not to see the impact of Blade's Eidolons considering the way that they designed them. Blade's first Eidolon is an increase to the overall scaling damage on his ultimate, and although this is a lot of text, it's simply a damage increase. Spoiler alert, there's a lot of Eidolons that look like this coming up. His second Eidolon enhances his crit rate by 15% when under the effect of Hellscape, which essentially means that he has a permanent additional 15% crit rate. This doesn't need explaining, but 15% free crit rate when his light cone already gives a decent amount is just absurd. Usually this is the part where I would make the remark that the character's third and fifth Eidolons are simply decent at best, considering their flat increases, but I just wanted to point out how funny it is that they swapped the basic and skill increase Eidolon with the ultimate and talent Eidolon. It's like they knew that we would focus on basic and skill damage instead. Blade's fourth Eidolon increases his max health by 20% when he dips below 50% health, and it stacks twice. The actual usages of this Eidolon will vary, but like the Eidolons before this, it all contributes to his overall damage. Having a decent increase in health will certainly be noticeable when you're trying to stay alive longer. But how long you'll stay at sub 50% health is up for debate. The sixth and final Eidolon for Blade is somewhat of a functional change with a reduction in total needed charges. But that, paired with the increase in damage to his follow-up attack, further emphasized the stat stick. This is just for more damage and not functionally changing Blade as a concept narrative. To be clear, a character whose Eidolons focus entirely around providing free stats is by no means bad, but it does mean that pulling for extra copies feels less worth it than usual. Luocha, by contrast, changes his role as a healer to that of a debuffer once enough Eidolons are obtained. Overall, Eidolons are a luxury, not a necessity, and Blade is a perfect example of a character who definitely doesn't need his Eidolon. There are several ways to play Blade, but I found two playstyles that really accentuate how strong he is. The first is as a solo DPS pseudo tank like Clara, who has supportive characters to supplement his gameplay. And the second is as a slot in DPS, who is self-sufficient and can be paired with other tanks, healers, supports, and play flexibly. With this in mind, a team like Natasha, Asta, Payla, and Blade do well considering how many buffs, debuffs, and breaks are possible. Payla as a defense reduction, Asta as an attack and speed increase, and Natasha for safety all contribute to a well-balanced team composition. Couple in the fact that the characters are either 4 stars or given for free, and it's clear why a team like this can be so powerful. If we take a detour, a less accessible but giga-powerful team composition would involve Luocha, Tingyun, Bronya, and the Beefcake himself. This team composition is pretty ridiculous and can be flexible, but in case you haven't seen the 100 guides that say two supports are OP, it just is. Look at these numbers. But first, I do want to mention that allowing Bronya to go after Blade is pretty important. This allows him to use his skill and then basic with the enhanced attack after being given the extra turn. Alternatively, you could swap the team around and have Silverwolf, but it's really dependent on the encounter. What I will say though is that a Blade buffed and attacking a low defense team is extremely satisfying. Blade is Star Rail's second attempt at a health scaling damage dealer, and he does this pretty well. Between juggling a fun playstyle and sacrificing health for damage and eliminating an entire field with one hit, there's not much to hate about this playstyle. Ultimately, future content will determine just how crazy he is, but I'm positive that he matches Clara and outpaces Arlan at the very minimum. Anywho, I hope you guys learned a thing or two about Blade from this guide. I'm super excited to continue playing, testing, experimenting with this character. If you have a sec, make sure to check out my Twitch, Discord to keep, you know, get involved in whatever stupid nonsense I'm doing, theory crafting, etc., etc. Make sure to like, let me know what you thought about Blade, if he's good, if he's bad. Turn the notification bell, subscribe, all that jazz. Thanks so much, guys. I'll see you on the next one. Adios.